Hello, everyone. Can I have everyone's attention, please? Thank you so much for being here at Grand Rounds. I'd like to talk about Dr. Sergio Thal, who's completed his internal medicine cardiology training in Buenos Aires, Argentina, where he was also a chief fellow. He subsequently completed his EP fellowship at the Cleveland Clinic and served as the director of cardiac EP at the VA healthcare system in southern Arizona. Dr. Thal has been selected in the Marquis Who's Who in America, as well as the Best Doctors list. He has recently been recruited to Case Western Reserve University and the Harrington Heart and Vascular Center. He also brings with him multiple grants, including an NIH grant for over $3 million for the study of myofilament-based mechanism of diastolic dysfunction in heart failure with preserved ES. More importantly, according to Barb, he's also a very nice guy to work with. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Thal. Thank you.
Hey, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for having me here. As was said, I just joined the UH, and I was asked to give a presentation. I tried to find something that actually was clinically attractive and also relevant for today's practice. So I'm going to be talking today about the indications for defibrillators, implantable defibrillators in a population with non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. There is a new data that appeared just barely a month ago or so that actually contradicts everything that we were doing so far. So the idea of this talk will be basically to go over that data, compare the data with the data that was supporting the guidance, and give you my opinion about it at the very end. So the term dilated cardiomyopathy actually is in the practice used very commonly instead of non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. This is something that people use regardless the source of the cardiomyopathy. Basically, it involves a large group of heterogeneous myocardial disorders that they are characterized by ventricular dilatation, depressed myocardial contractility in the absence of other causes like hypertension or valvular disease. Of course, it's a requirement for these patients not to have evidence of coronary artery disease to be considered non-ischemic. This is data from the heart failure guidelines that were published in 2013. The age-adjusted prevalence of dilated cardiomyopathy is about 36 cases for every 100,000 population. And very important, it's considered to be the source of 10,000 deaths every year. The data from the device guidelines published in 2012 show that observational studies suggest that approximately 30% of the deaths in patients with dilated cardiomyopathy is sudden. So when we say sudden, we're talking probably about a life-threatening event like an arrhythmia that is causing the death of these patients. The mortality is medically treated patients with prior history of syncope is may exceed 30% every 2 years. And what is very, very important is that patients with this problem that are treated with an ICD, most of them experience an appropriate shock. Means that a big percentage of these patients with dilated cardiomyopathy end up having life-threatening arrhythmias that actually are being properly treated by the device. So the 2012 guidelines for device implants provide all the class 1 indications for these devices. And if we pay attention to point 5, there is a class 1 indication for patients with non-ischemic dilated cardiomyopathy who have a left ventricular ejection fraction equal or below 35%, who are in New York Heart Association class 2 to 3. So this is class 1. And based on these indications we've been practicing for the guidelines are from 2012, although the data is available at least from 2005. So these are the guidelines that are telling us so far today which patients should be implanted with devices. 2013, a year later, there was another guidelines publication. Actually, it was the evaluation of how appropriate were the indications from the guidelines. They built a score and actually named each of the indications on appropriate, maybe appropriate, or is not appropriate. And when you look at these, specifically in the table that talk about non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. What you can see here is that patients that were diagnosed and they were on appropriate treatment for at least 3 months. So here, if the diagnosis was less than 3 months, there is not a good indication. It's not appropriate. Although you diagnose non-ischemic, new diagnosis of non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, you treat him properly, medical treatment for 3 months. After 3 months, if the ejection fraction is 35% or lower, then the guidelines consider that it's a very appropriate indication for defibrillators. If the ejection fraction is in between 35 and 40, then it may be appropriate, although it's not a clear-cut class 1 indication. Okay? And so far, this is what we are using today to make the indications for these devices. This is the algorithm similar to what we just explained. If they are less than 3 months, probably no appropriate indication. Although if you are after 3 months of appropriate medical therapy, if the ejection fraction is less than 35, we're talking about non-ischemic, appropriate indication for the device. So where is the data to support the guidance coming from? So here is pretty much just an enumeration of the studies that actually provided the supporting data to the guidance. On the left side of the screen, these are the secondary preventions, evidence, SIDS. We're not going to talk about these trials today. In the right side, we have the primary prevention. That's actually the objective of this talk. The first three studies, MAST, MADIT, and MADIT 2, were actually studies that were done with patients with ischemic cardiomyopathy. I think are very well known, but most of us here. And we're not going to direct our attention to these particular three. We're going to actually point our attention to the last three, the definite companion and Scott test. These are the studies that actually provide the support for indication of devices in non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. Companion and SCOT-HF are studies that include both ischemic and non-ischemic patients, but basically the results of the study supported the indication in non-ischemic patients. So let's go first, what is new there? So as I mentioned before, about a month ago during the European meeting of cardiology, there was, if I'm not wrong, in the first day, there was very shocking data presented. That was actually almost immediately published in New England Journal of Medicine. This is a study from Denmark called the Danish study. And in a Danish study, what they did was evaluate people with non-ischemic cardiomyopathy regarding benefits, survival benefits about receiving a defibrillator or not receiving a defibrillator. They pretty much included around 560 patients in each group. They were all patients with non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, ejection fraction equal or less than 35%, and they were allocated to receive or not to receive a defibrillator, and everybody should receive optimal medical therapy. As you can tell from the results of the study, they show no difference, no significant P between the two groups. And the study authors concluded that prophylactic ICD has absolutely no impact in the mortality in this group of patients. This goes pretty much against whatever we are doing today, because as I just showed you before this data, we just see a patient with non-ischemic cardiomyopathy and low ejection fraction, automatically we consider it of benefit to provide an ICD. I propose you to review the data that actually support the guidelines and then compare with the new data. So I will start with this study. This study was not in the list that I just showed you. This is the AMIOVIRT study, although it's an important study because this was probably the first one that actually attempted to tackle the issue of the non-ischemic patients and the defibrillators. The study included, of course, non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, again, cut point for ejection fraction, 35% or less. These patients should have non-sustained ventricular tachycardias, and they should have been in New York Heart Association class 1 to 3. What is relevant in the study is that they expected that the population that did not receive a defibrillator will have a 20% death, while the population that received a defibrillator, they expected to reduce to 10%. So they were expecting from this study a 50% reduction in mortality with the use of defibrillators. This is the way the patients were treated in that study. As you can tell, the beta blockers was only 50% of the patients were receiving beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, 81 to 90% of the patients receiving it. You can tell here from this chart that the study was a negative study, no significant difference between both groups, and the authors of this study concluded that defibrillators did not impact mortality on this population. A year later, 2004, the definitive study was published, and this was actually probably the one that started to turn the attention back to non-ischemic cardiomyopathy and defibrillator. In this study, again, included non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, same ejection fraction, patients with some kind of ventricular arrhythmia, PVCs, or non-sustained VT. They included 458 patients. They randomized 229 patients in each group, and they were divided to standard medical therapy versus medical therapy plus single-chamber ICD. So this was just a shock box. This was not programmed to do ATP. This was not programmed. It was just if you have an arrhythmia, the device will just give you a shock. The study, again, was powered to detect 50% reduction in mortality with the use of defibrillators. Treatment, what was considered appropriate medical treatment for these patients, beta blockers, much better than the amiovir. Remember, amiovir was 50%. Here went to 85%. ACE inhibitors, pretty similar to amiovir, 85%, 87%. And here are the results. So when you look at death from any cause, the ICD showed a tendency towards benefit, although didn't reach statistical significance. But when you look at sudden death from arrhythmia, and that's very important. So the question always is, what are you going to ask the device to do? So this is a device that actually will treat arrhythmic death. The device, a defibrillator, a single lead shock defibrillator, will not prevent you from having heart failure, will not prevent you from dying from something else. It will just prevent you from having an arrhythmic death. So when you look at the data from sudden death from arrhythmia, the device did significantly better than just medical treatment. And what we also need to have in mind in this study is that only approximately one-third of the deaths in the standard therapy group were due to arrhythmias. This is not minor, because the way to look how our treatment is going to impact the survival of these patients is to see what happened with the patients that we didn't do the therapy. And if we look at this group, it's the control group, and we see how many of them actually have a sudden death from an arrhythmia, and we see that only one-third of them had an arrhythmia. And we're still expecting the device to decrease 50% all-cause mortality. In my opinion, the numbers do not match up. Okay, so we're talking about a population that have a very low arrhythmic mortality. In the same year, the companion study was published. The companion study is a little more complicated design, but it's a very relevant study for us today. So it included, again, as I mentioned at the beginning, ischemic and non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. The patients were sicker than the previous studies. The previous studies were class 1 to 3. In this case, they were included 3 and 4. So we're targeting a sicker portion of the population. Again, low ejection fraction. And one of the requirements was a QRS interval more than 120 milliseconds. The reason of that is because this study included bi-V pacing. And by the guidelines, in order for somebody to get a bi-V pacing, you need to have a wide QRS. So that's why every patient that was included in the study that was potentially be randomized to receive IV pacing should have a QRS interval longer than 120 milliseconds. Included 1,500 patients and were randomized to medical therapy plus IV pacemaker, so this is a IV device without ICD, or medical therapy plus IV ICD. The primary endpoint was death from or hospitalization from any cause. And now the study was powered to show a benefit of 25% in the group that received an ICD. This is the results, the chart. It's probably known by everybody here, but just going quickly over the results. The primary endpoint, remember, was death or hospitalization from any cause. The devices groups, both of them, show significant benefits compared with the group that just received medical therapy. The secondary endpoint that was all-cause mortality, the devices did much better than medical therapy, although only the group that received BIV defibrillator did statistically better than the group that received medical therapy. So this was actually one of the first studies that included non-ischemic cardiomyopathy that actually was showing that a defibrillator will save lives in this group of patients. There was a tendency in the pacemaker group, although it was not significant. And again, death from or hospitalization from cardiovascular causes was much better with devices. And of course, death or hospitalization from heart failure did much better with the devices. Remember, these two groups with devices were having BIV paging, so they were having specific treatment for heart failure. That it was expected that the death of admission for heart failure will be better in these two groups. As a result from the study, so if you look at death from any cause and you look at pacemakers, it was a tendency, although not significant difference. When you look at pacemaker defibrillators, there was a clear benefit for the devices in this group of patients. So a year later, I would say it will be the flagship for the indication for defibrillator in this group study, the SCOTCAP was published. And they, again, included very similar population, ischemic and non-ischemic, as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk. Patients were class 2 or 3, low ejection fraction, included 2,500 patients, and divided in three groups. One group had conventional medical therapy, another group with medical therapy plus amiodarone, and a third group with medical therapy plus ICD. The endpoint, again, all-cause mortality, and again, they were looking for a benefit of 25% reduction in mortality in the group with amiodarone or ICD. This is the way the patients were treated. So when we look at beta blockers, 69% in the groups, clearly better than amiodarone, not any better than the previous other studies, so fair but not perfect. When we look at ACE inhibitors, pretty much the same as the previous studies, 80-something percent. Here are the results. And the results you have in green is the group that received an ICD. Blue and red are the medical treatment with and without amiodarone. And as you can tell, the group that received an ICD did significantly better than the patients that did not receive an ICD. So this is the main study, the main one that actually supports the guidelines to tell us we should do these devices in this group of patients. When they separated the groups, and again, the study was not powered to evaluate these two groups separately, although if you look at ischemic and non-ischemic, in both cases, the curves look pretty much alike. There is a tendency to significant with the ICD and in both groups, although none of them was clearly statistically significant. But again, the study was powered to look at the whole group as one, was not powered to actually look at these two different subpopulations. So the findings from this study was that using a shock-only device, there was a significant decrease, relative risk of death of 23% by using a defibrillator. And another valuable outcome from the study was proved that amiodarone had absolutely no benefit in this group of patients. So basically, after this study, there was no any more studies done that were comparing amiodarone versus no amiodarone for sudden death prevention. So let's go back to the beginning of the talk, and let's go back to the Danish study. As I mentioned before, the Danish study was done in Denmark. Denmark is a socialized medicine. They have predetermined hospitals where the implants are going to be done. So they recruited patients in all these hospitals that do ICD implants. This was investigator-initiated, multicenter, randomized, unblinded, controlled trial. It included patients class 2 or 3 New York Heart Association. Only class 4 is they also meet criteria for BIVs. So if they were class 4 and they did not meet criteria for BIV, were not included in the study. Of course, non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, low ejection fraction, and they also require that there should be a biomarker for heart failure. They use NT-proBNP that should be more than 200 picograms per milliliter. the primary outcome was death from any cause. And they also look at other secondary outcomes, sudden cardiac death, cardiovascular death, resuscitated from cardiac arrest, change from baseline in quality of life. And the study was powered to detect a 25% decrease in mortality with the use of defibrillators. This is how the study actually was done. It included about 1,100 patients. We have a little over 600 patients that actually meet criteria for BIVs. 19 of these patients already had a BIV pacemaker, so these patients were randomized to stay with the pacemaker that they have or to be upgraded to a BIV ICD if they were actually randomized to ICD. Of course, the other group was randomized to receive CRT pacemaker or CRT ICD. And then we have about 470 patients that did not meet criteria for CRT, and they were randomized to receive ICD versus no ICD. Every patient in the four groups should have optimal medical therapy. Here is how the patients were treated. When we look at the beta blockers, 92% in both groups actually received beta blockers. This is much better than any other study that we have seen before. So remember, the Amiovir only have 50% treatment with beta blockers. There was something like 60% in Scott Heff. This study had 92% treatment with beta blockers. Look at the ACE inhibitors. 96, 97%. Almost everybody in this study was treated with ACE inhibitors. When we look at the previous studies, 60, 70%, 80%. So these patients were treated better than any patient from anybody here in this room. So I'm pretty sure that none of us are treating the patients so perfectly like the way these patients were treated in the study. Also very important, we're going to talk about all these issues a little bit later, CRT. 60% of the patients in both groups received BIV. And this is not a minor thing, and I'm going to mention this later. What were the results? Okay, I went over the results a little bit earlier today. When we look at death from any cause, there was no significant difference, and we showed that graph at the very beginning. What happened when we look at the subgroups and we look at sudden death, sudden cardiac death? And this is pretty much the group that, as I mentioned before, this is the group that we should expect the defibrillator to do something about. There was statistically significant benefit for the defibrillator compared with the non-defibrillator group. Of course, when we look at your chances of dying suddenly, of dying from an arrhythmia, the defibrillator, it does much better than medical therapy. When you look about all the variables included in the study, there was almost no difference from anything, with the exception probably of age. This is something remarkable of the study, and again, I'm going to talk about this in a little bit. When you look at patients that were younger than 59 years old, this group clearly benefited from receiving an ICD. So this side of the curve, better ICD, this side, better medical therapy. Patients that were 59 years old and older saw no benefit from the defibrillator. And this is very interesting and important in my opinion. And I'm going to go over this a little bit later. So, what's the difference between the Danish trial and the data that we were actually using so far to use this device? So let's start with the medication. And I already talked a little bit about it. So medications. Here in this chart, probably the Amiovir is not here. But remember, beta blockers, Amiovir 50%. In the best case scenario, indefinite study, 85%. Danish study, 92% of the patients received beta blockers. So we know today that you use beta blockers, you name it, MERIT, HF, CV study. We know that use of beta blockers in non-ischemic cardiomyopathy reduce mortality. What about ACE inhibitors? We can go back to the early 90s with the SOLVE study. We know that just using ACE inhibitors reduce mortality in this population. Look at the difference. The best of the cases, maybe 85%. In the Danish study, almost everybody was on treatment with ACE inhibitors. ARBs, almost no treatment with ARBs before. 58% of the patients in the Danish study were also receiving ARBs. So this is excellent treatment. So you take a group, you subselect a group, and then you treat this group better than anybody else will treat these patients. And what happened with CRT? Use of CRT before. Definite study, absolutely no use of CRT. Companion, 79%, remember, this was a kind of a tricky design because in the companion study, two of the three groups actually were randomized to receive BIV, but none in the control group received BIV. Scott Heft, absolutely no patient received BIV. Danish study, 58% of the patients received BIV. So let me tell you why I think it's important to make this difference with the results of this study. So I will take you back to 2005 with the publication of the CARE-HF study. This was a very important study. I would call it a landmark study because it was the first one that actually showed benefit from only BIV pacing this group of patients. The study, as I say, was run in Europe, included patients in class 3 and 4. They were patients with dilated cardiomyopathy, and they were randomized, both groups, to receive medical therapy plus or less BIV pacing. No one of these patients in this group actually was implanted with a defibrillator. Medical therapy, excellent. Pretty close to the one that we see in the Danish trial. ACE inhibitors, 95%. Beta blockers, not as good, although better than the previous studies, 70-something percent. When we look at the results of the CARE-HF, the death or hospitalization from cardiovascular events, clearly BIV pacing did significantly better than just medical therapy. When we look at death from any cause, again, the BIV pacemaker did significantly better than the medical therapy. And this is very important because, I mean, for the first time, this study was showing that if you just give BIV, you are already saving lives. So let me go back again and say, you take a very selected population, you treat them excellent with medical therapy, better than anybody else. Then on top of this, you give them BIV pacing. 60% in each group had BIV pacing. And then on top of this, you're expecting your device, the defibrillator, to decrease 25% mortality. I'm not very sure this is very fair. So let me bring you back one more study, and that actually will question if it is appropriate to ask the defibrillator to achieve this 25% reduction. It's a study done by the group of McMurray. McMurray is the author of the editorial that accompanied the publication of this paper in New England. And they did a very nice study published a year ago in Shack Heart Failure. And the study was titled Falling Cardiovascular Mortality in Heart Failure with Reduced Ejection Fraction and Implication for Clinical Trials. This was a meta-analysis and included studies that had at least 400 patients between 1986 and 2014. As a result, it ended up including a total of 60 trials that summarized about 130,000 patients that included about 32,000 deaths. So it's a big, big number. 90% of the patients were in New York Heart Association class 2 and 3, and the average ejection fraction of the patients included in these studies was 27%. So we're talking about a group of patients with a heart failure, low ejection fraction. What they did in the study is they compare what happened based on the way you were treating these patients and how they died. And what they did was to divide the population in three groups. The group of trials that used less than 33% of beta blockers, another group that used between 33 and 66% of the patients were on beta blockers, and finally the group that more than 66% of the patients received beta blockers. And then they compare how the patients died. And here, if you concentrate in these two lines, you have cardiovascular death and you have non-cardiovascular death. In the group with the lower use of beta blockers, the cardiovascular death was 87%. As we move forward in the other groups, as the beta blocker treatment increased, it drops to 81% and to 79.5% in the group that used more than 66%. So the better the patients are treated medically, the less chances from dying from cardiovascular reasons. In the same token, when we look at non-cardiovascular death, the more the use of beta blockers, the higher the mortality for other reasons, non-cardiac. So, if we treat these patients so well, they're going to die because people die anyway. The question is, how are they going to die? If they don't die from cardiac diseases, how do we expect the defibrillator to do something about it? So what happened in the Danish study? The Danish study used 92% of beta blockers, way more than most of these studies done in the last 20 years. What happened with the cardiovascular death? 68.5%. The average of these groups, of these studies that use more than 66% beta blockers, was 79.5. So the mortality, cardiovascular mortality in the Danish trial was way lower than the average of the studies published in the last 20 years. And what happened with the non-cardiovascular death? 31.4%, a little more, will be almost double of the non-cardiovascular death on the studies published in the last 20 years. So we're taking this group of patients, very selected. We treat them perfectly well. We give a device. We have a population that actually is not going to die from cardiac disease. They're going to die from something else. And we still expect the defibrillator to do a 25% reduction in mortality. The same group actually show what happened when you progress in the year. So they assume the closer to today, the better the treatment for heart failure. Here is the ischemic, the cardiovascular mortality. Here is the non-cardiovascular mortality. And you can tell the better the treatment, the lower the mortality, the cardiovascular mortality. The better the treatment, the higher the non-cardiovascular mortality. So today we're facing people that are dying, but many of them are dying from something else, not cardiac disease. As a result of the study, the author suggests that all-cause mortality is becoming an increasingly insensitive endpoint for the evaluation of new treatments for heart failure. The point may be even more important for older patients. The older you get, you're going to die, but if you are well-treated, most likely you're going to die from something else, not cardiovascular disease. So the author thinks, and I kind of agree with this, that there should be a move towards use disease-specific endpoints for the trials instead of keep using all-cause mortality, mostly in a group of patients that are actually going to die from something else than what we are trying to treat. Finally, well, not finally, a little bit more, but what is the real impact of ICDs? So it's very important that you look at what is the arrhythmic death in the control group to see what's going to be the impact of the defibrillator. And when you look at this, and again, I compare it here, the Scott-Hepp trial that, as I said at the beginning, I think is a flagship for the guidance indication versus the Danish study, the arrhythmic death in the Scott-Hepp was much higher than the arrhythmic death in the Danish trial. So again, the Danish trial didn't show benefit, but actually these patients were dying from something else, were not having arrhythmic death. Now, yes, finally, I will just give a few words about what is the impact of age. I think this is a very important point. ICDs, it's a very expensive therapy. The guidelines do not discriminate between the age of the patient that received the defibrillators. The guidelines say if you have a non-ischemic cardiomyopathy and your ejection fraction is low, you should receive a defibrillator. In clinical practice, we're giving devices to very old patients that many times they're going to die from something else instead of an arrhythmia. We're trying to prevent a sudden death. But again, there is no data that is telling us you should not provide a defibrillator to these patients. So in the Danish trial, as I mentioned before, it's showing that patients less than 59 years old benefit. It makes sense. Pretty much if you are 59 years old or younger, so you're in a younger group of patients, and you have a non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, if you're going to die, it's very likely that you're going to die from a cardiac issue. Very likely. It's just statistics. You're young, you have non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, your chances from dying is dying from that. If you're an old patient and you have non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, yeah, you will die, but you may die from many other things too. So the benefit of the defibrillator in the older population is not as good as in the younger population. That's the conclusion. The population in Danish was an ideal treatment compared with regular patients. The percentage of CRT, as we mentioned before, was considerably high compared with any other studies previously done. the overall mortality was very low, as I showed before. So pretty much, if we are including a measure that will impact mortality, our chances are also pretty low. Was the study too ambitious for the ICDs? In my personal opinion, yes. I think that the study was expecting the defibrillator to have an impact in a population that was not correctly selected, or the study was not correctly designed to show the benefits of the ICD. The ICD in the study actually showed a 13% relative reduction in mortality. It was not significant based on the design of the study, although on top of all these that I mentioned, the defibrillators were still saving some lives in the study. In my opinion, there will not be an immediate impact of the guidelines with this study because the study has a lot of areas that need to be reinvestigated. There will be a need for more studies, although there's a big ethical problem. So let me just picture you a situation. So the current guidelines says, as I mentioned very many times today, non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, low ejection fraction need to have an ICD. So now today, let's say we decide to redo the Scott Heft. We decide to do it again because we say, oh, okay, there is controversial data. We need to do it again to make sure that what we're doing is right. We're going to redo the Scott Heft. We're going to treat medically perfectly well these patients like the Danish study did. And then we're going to tell the patient, listen, I know the guidelines say I need to give you an ICD, but because you're going to be in the study, I'm not going to give you an ICD. How are you? How do you think the patients are going to feel about it? So today, with the guidelines saying that this patient should receive an ICD, will be a big ethical dilemma to conduct a study like this. So it will be very, very hard to find a study design that can overcome this ethical issue and still be able to test this hypothesis. Finally, the age-related implant. As I mentioned before, I think this is a very important issue. I'm not sure it's going to impact the guidelines also, although I hope it does, because I think that we should do a better work by choosing the best target population that should receive the ICD. And in many cases, we're giving these devices to people that actually will not benefit from them. So in my opinion, age-related implant is something that we are going to be hearing, and I think it's a very relevant issue. And I want to thank you, everybody, for being today.